Praise God. I want to know if we got any men on fire in this house. Well, I'm telling you, yes, hallelujah. We are privileged to have you guys here. This kind of snuck up on me before I had a chance to really get my notes out. But anyway, I want to take this minute to welcome you to New Beginnings Worship Center. And I want to thank each one of you for coming. It really means a lot to us. And this is our second annual Men on Fire Conference. Amen. Amen. We had a great conference last year, but our goal and our vision in the next couple of years is this thing grows so big, and this is what we're asking God to do, that we have to have it down at the park down in Brewton. So link Shields with us, and let's ask God to do this thing. Amen? For this year, our conference theme, through prayer, as you can see on our shirts, is all in. And I believe the Father's calling men of God to be men of God, to be all in. God is calling us to be better fathers. God is calling us to be better husbands. And most of all, He's calling us to be the spiritual leaders in our homes, in our churches, and in our communities, being the light of Jesus Christ in a lost and dying world. Amen? Amen. You know, Jesus said, those who are not with me are against me, didn't he? Huh? See, guys, there is no neutral zone. There is no gray area. You're either all in or you're all out. And God's looking for some men to be all in. When you came in the door, you were given a booklet. And it's called Going All In. And I love the way God orchestrates things, because God is always on time. We were in one of our men on fire meetings that we was having them on Wednesday nights, and then we started having them on Sunday nights, and we were sitting there and talking, and Brother Mike Flowers, he looked at me, he said, Brother Tim, we've got to be men that are all in. And when he said that, man, the Holy Spirit just stamped that in our spirits, and that became our theme. Well, about a week later, Brother Reed Sorrell, who was not in our meeting, came up, and he gave me this booklet, Going All In. And if that wasn't a confirmation from the Lord about men, calling men to be all in. And could it be that in that book, in page 12, I believe it is, says this. It said, in this booklet, it said, could it be that we have adopted an inverted gospel? Many in churches today think they are following Jesus, but are we really? Could it be that we have invited Jesus to follow us? Wow. And serve our purpose than rather serving His purpose. But are we really? Could it be that we have invited Jesus to follow us and serve our purpose? We call Him Savior, but have we completely surrendered and made Him Lord? And that's a question we all have to ask ourselves as men of God in this house tonight. I pray by the end of tonight, you'll be ignited and set on fire by the Holy Ghost of God. God has ordained this meeting. God has set the right people in place, not only to lead us in worship and praise, but not only that, a mighty man of God to lead us in the Word of God. And I'm thankful for Him. Jesus said to His disciples, if any man choose to follow me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whosoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Now here's the stinger, guys. For what profit is a man to gain the whole world and to lose his own soul? I think it's time we pack our coffins and become men of God who are all in. Amen? Come on, give God some praise for that. At this time, I'd like to have my pastor, Pastor Bo Bell, come up and go over some announcements. I thank God for this man. He's done a lot of work for the kingdom of God, and I bless him. Thank you, Pastor, for all you do.
Thank you, brother. Come on, let's give the Lord some praise. Oh, come on, you can do better than that. After all the Lord done for you, come on. Hallelujah. It's good to see you in the house tonight, amen? There's a preaching anointing in here because there's an anointed preacher in the house, amen? I had a chance to share with Brother Toby a while ago that when my daughter was real little, me and my wife was going through a divorce years ago, and I lived in Earlville out on the other side of, out on the end of Moffett Road, and I picked her up on a Friday evening, and we started up Moffett Road, and Pathway was there on the right, and there was cars everywhere, and she said, "Daddy, let's go to that church." She loved going to church with me. And we pulled in and eased in the back, and the man of God was preaching Fire Down. We sat there on the back row. The church was pretty full. He did an altar call. My daughter went to the altar. Amen. And got saved that night. So I appreciate you, brother. Appreciate you. Amen. God knows what he's doing. I would like to thank Brother Tim, not only for what you've done tonight, but what you've done for the men's ministry in this church. Let's give Brother Tim a hand clap of praise. Amen. All of you men that's helped to make it come to pass, there is some men on fire in this place. Amen. Anointed men of God. I'm excited about that. I thank Brother Toby again tonight. But a special thanks to each of you. Some of you have never been here before. I want to thank you tonight because there's car tags out there from Baldwin County, Mobile, and all around. So we thank you so much for being here tonight. I want to make a quick announcement, and I'm going to get out of your way. After this conference, on July the 28th at 6:30, right back here in the sanctuary, I want all men, every man you can find or bring, we even gonna bring the guys out of the youth in this room here and start a new program to try to teach men and mentor men more, starting to see things different from the eyes of a youth. When you see our youth and how they are on fire and how many of them was at this church last night, it's time for me and you to begin to pick us up, six or eight of them, and mentor them. And so on July the 28th, we want to meet in here. It's going to be a serious meeting, amen? So we want to make sure that we're here and we're ready and we're attentive to what God is saying. There's two kind of men in this room, some that's ready to be mentored and some that's able to mentor others. And we want to try to bridge that gap together and see what we can do for the kingdom of God, amen? So we want to talk about building men from the ground up. Amen. Building men from the ground up. Do you know how you do that? You got to pick them up when they're falling.
That's right.
All right, I'm going to leave you alone with that then. But it's about helping discover your purpose. I want to teach you to walk in boldness and walk in the authority of God. I think about today, how we can have a good service on Sunday, Holy Ghost falling, people getting healed and set free around the altars. And on Monday, you can see one of the men that was praising here on Sunday defeated because of not being able to walk in authority on Monday. Come on, somebody. And so we got to learn how to walk in that authority every day and put those devils to flight and don't let them steal our joy. Amen? Amen. Amen. Are you in for that? Are you all in for being in authority? Amen. And so Brother Tim touched on a lot of what I wanted to say, but men, our families need us. Our wives need us. Our community needs us. Our nation needs us. Our community is crying out for men of God. Amen. What's taking place here is undeniable, and you see it all over the city. If you go somewhere to go shopping, somebody's there wanting you to pray for them, and things are starting to happen. There's a sound going out, and so I want you to understand that you have a purpose in the kingdom. Amen. And so I just want to say this to you tonight. If you want to be part of an accountability group and a mentoring group that wants to see each other grow and mentor I've put a program together. I've been working on it since January. Travis has put it on a jump drive, and I want to get some more men in this church to commit to mentoring somebody else. Amen?
Amen.
And we got the structure laid out, and we believe in God for great things.
Yes.
Are you ready for that?
Yes.
Amen. Well, thank you so much for being here tonight. Brother Joey, will you come? One other quick thing, real quick. I want to remind you that my wife will be doing this same thing with all of the ladies, and we'll announce it more in the morning, but she'll be doing it with the ladies that night, and there will be child care. We want to see the whole family walk in authority. Amen?
Yes, Lord. Y'all come on, give God some praise for that right there. I feel like God's saying for men, it's time to come up a little bit. You know, for too long, we've let the enemy take men out of the house. But God's saying it's time for men to rise up and step into the place of authority where you're supposed to be. Okay? There is a preaching anointing in here, too. I feel it, boy. I tell you what, now. My God. Real quick, I just want to share something with you. A question that come to mind right off the top of my head is this. Is your household starving spiritually?
Oh, Lord.
Is your household starving spiritually? If so, you to blame for it. I'm just being real, you to blame for it, because see, God made you the head, not the tail. And so you're responsible for your house. You're responsible. If your wife's struggling and falling spiritually, it's your fault. If she sees you reading the word, if she hears you praying, if she hears you telling her God said this, God's doing this, then she might get on board with it. You see what I'm saying? So if she's struggling and fishing to fall out, maybe you need to pick something up. Okay, then? So whatever a man sows, that's what he'll reap. So if you ain't sowing nothing in your house, you ain't reaping a blessing. If you ain't sowing nothing in your marriage, you ain't reaping a blessing. You see what I'm saying? And so I bring this up because, guys, y'all can come on with us to take up an offering. Because men's meetings, there is an expense to it. Now, it's free to you. It don't cost you a dime. You can show up here and leave with a blessing. Because God will always make a way. God will make a way. But there is expenses. And, you know, we want to be able to bless the people that come and be able to keep it free for people. But in order to keep it free and to feed everybody and to make it a joy and a blessing, it takes finances. And so, just to let you know, it's okay. You don't have to give now, so don't feel obligated, because the price to be here tonight was paid for 2,000 years ago. You see what I'm saying? But I want you to think about it like this. Whatever we sow into, we're going to reap a harvest from. And so if it means something to you, you'll invest in it. Okay? Whatever level that you determine the value of something to be will be the level that you determine your sacrifice to be. And that will be the level that you sow into something. So whatever you sowing into, you're going to reap a harvest. So if you sow in hell, you're going to get hell. You see what I'm saying? But if you sow in blessings, you're going to get a blessing. Okay? So I want to take up the offering. Whatever God lays on your heart, if all you got's $2 and you give it, you give more than somebody that had $1,000 and give $100. You see what I'm saying? So whatever God lays on you, I don't want you to feel obligated, but if God moves on your heart, then sow a seed. Sow a seed, because here's the thing. I want you to understand this right here, that if you sow a seed, this one's already paid for, but next year, if you sow a seed and somebody gets saved next year, you reaping a harvest from that because you sowed into it. You see what I'm saying? So whatever we sow into, we reap a harvest. So before I pray over this offering, one question. What you sowing into? What you sowing into? Amen. Father, we just love you, God, and we thank you so much for your mercy and grace. And Father, I pray for Shekinah glory to fall here tonight. Lord, I pray a double portion of anointing over the pastor that's coming to speak tonight, God. Lord, that rhema would fall. Lord, that conviction would be on the sermon that he brings. And Father, Lord, that you would search our hearts, God. Search the deep things of us, Lord, and leave no stone left unturned here tonight. Father, I pray that you break us down, God, until we are in a place that you can remodel mold us and reshape us into the men that you have ordained a man of God to be. And Father, we love you, and we pray that you bless this offering, God, that it will advance your kingdom, God, and souls will be saved from it. And we love you and praise your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Sit. The other thing has been, well, when I was a child, I used to think as a child. But when I become a man, I put childish ways behind me. And you know, for some of us, that'll make us cringe because we still got some childish things in our box. But if we're going to do this thing right, we got to put the childish ways behind us and set our feet on a rock. Right? Now, come on, let's worship God. If you've been walking the same old road, miles and miles, you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. You're trying to fill the same old holes inside, but there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. Savior, if you got chains, chains that set me free. Lord, I want to be washed clean. Don't you know I want to be washed clean? Father, take away my pride. Just set it all aside. So I might hear what you have to say. Coming around to crucify. starts rising. Cause even when the storm comes, I am washed by the water. Come on, guys, isn't the goal here to see the Lord? How many of you believe that his training fills this temple right now? I see the Lord, and his train fills the temple. I see the Lord, and his high lifted up, and angels cry, holy, holy is the Lord, and angels cry. See the Lord, and his eyes are flaming like fire. And angels cry, holy, holy is the Lord. And angels cry. Touched the cold to my lips. Come on. Now all of my guilt is gone, and all my sin has been forgiven. And I love that old where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I will cherish the till my trophies at last I lay down. So I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday. And the old rugged cross stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For on that old cross someday for a crown. So I will cherish the old rugged cross until my trophies at last I lay down. And I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
My God, come on. I don't know about you in this house, but I thank God. That old rugged cross, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. It was the precious blood of Jesus Christ dying on that cross, atoning for you and I. And that's why we can say, Abba Father, Abba Father. Oh, come on, y'all give God some praise in this house tonight. He's worthy of our praise. Worship you in this house. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Man, I thank God. I thank God. About a year ago, after we had our last Men on Fire event, I began to ask the Lord. I said, Lord, I know it's a year out. I said, who do you want to come and speak to the men of God? And immediately he said, Toby Morgan. Come on. So I got... Matter of fact, I sent Pastor Morgan a messenger text, and I said, I feel in my spirit talking to the Lord, Pastor Morgan. I said, the Lord wants you to come and speak to us men at our Men on Fire conference. And Pastor Morgan said, it's an honor for me to come and speak to the men. Immediately, I think, Brother Morgan, you knew it was of God that you'd be here. Andrew got married and tried to knock it off course. That's his son who got married. But we rescheduled, and Pastor Morgan is here today to share the word of God with us. I had the privilege, and some of you in the house had the privilege, to sit under Pastor Morgan for several years, hearing his anointed preaching, feeding us men of God, challenging us men of God to be the spiritual leaders of our household, being the men of God, rising up, being salt and light, and being light on a hill. And I'm thankful for you, Pastor Morgan. And I want to say this. Since Pathway, Pastor Morgan had kind of rose up in the ranks, and now he said this will get you a dime, will get you a cup of coffee a while ago, but it's an honor because the assembly trusts you. The Church of God trusts you, and you've proven yourself time and time again to be a mighty man of God. So Pastor Morgan is now Bishop Morgan, and he is now the state overseer for the state of Arkansas. So with that being said, let's give the man of God a hand clap of praise, and Jesus, pray for him being here. Come on, brother, and bring us the word.
Praise the Lord. It's an honor and a delight to be with you. And I'm grateful, Brother Tim, for the privilege to come and to share with the men here in Brewton. As he said, we've actually bumped a couple of times. I've tried to get here and some things came up and scheduling, but he was gracious enough to work with me. And I appreciate you being here and thankful for the good things of the Lord and all that God is doing, and to meet some of you and to see some of you again. What a privilege and an honor it is to see you. You guys, some of you were, like, as he said, were part of the Pathway time in my life. Diane and I will tell you that the greatest years of our life were spent, 7 or so years there in Mobile with some of you, and as a pastor, and I don't think we'll ever have as good a time as we had there. And it was a delight and an honor to be with you and to see you. These guys, you've come up from a Pathway that we knew back then. They're just gluttons for punishment, you know, to come in here again. I'll tell you how they treated me when I was a pastor there. You guys know these, you go into these bathrooms now, and they got these hot air blowers, you know, that blow your hands. You like those with the jet engines in them that will almost take the skin off, you know, those things? They blow that hot air out. We put those in at Pathway, and I saw signs up that said, for a free sample of today's sermon, place hands under here, and all that hot air. Yeah, that's how they were. That's how bad, you know, they were rough. But thank you for coming, guys. I get to spend some time and see you guys, and we're honored to be here. And it's good to be with a group of men that just want to serve the Lord. I want to get closer to the Lord, and I want God to bless and to minister. I started some time back, and one of the dangerous things about something like this when you prepare for it for a while is you get a lot more to say than you need to say. So we'll try to work through this stuff here. But sometime back when Brother Tim was talking to me about coming, the Lord dropped something in my spirit and it began to surface. And so I want to just dig in tonight a little bit and talk to you about Jacob and about how life can be turned around and the glory of the Lord can be made evident in our lives in spite of ourselves, you know, in spite of us getting in our way. You ever get in your own way? I'm just a dumb little boy from up in, out of Walker County, Alabama, and I get in my own way a lot more. The devil doesn't have to do a lot to me. I'll do enough to myself. You know, I just, you know, that kind of stuff. I tell him all the time, I'm the king of stupid. Yeah, I've done a lot of dumb things. When I was a kid, growing up there in Summerton, a little small town, I was, you know, I watched G.I. Joe, and I thought, man, how cool it would be to jump out of an airplane. Yeah. Parachute out of a plane. And so, you know, when you're about 6 years old, you don't have a lot of planes or parachutes available. But I did have bed sheets and a ladder. And I got a bed sheet one time and climbed up on the roof of my house, and I G.I. Joe'd it out. And I learned three things real quick. Number one, I learned that a bed sheet's not a parachute. And number two, I learned that when you don't have a parachute but a bed sheet, the ground comes at you real quick. And three, I'd have been 6'5". I learned because I drove at least 8 inches a leg up in me when I, stupid stuff. I get in my own way as much as anything else. And so I want to talk to you tonight a few minutes about a guy that did that, but about how in spite of himself, in spite of his weaknesses and his propensity to mess up, God worked mightily in his life. And I think most of us in this room can identify with him. His story is found in Genesis chapter 28. I'm just going to read to you a few verses, and we'll dig into the word. Genesis 28:16. Jacob is running, and he kind of camps out. He has one of those Boy Scout experiences out in the wilderness. And Jacob awoke from his sleep, and he said, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I didn't know it." And he was afraid, and he said, "How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven." And Jacob rose early in the morning, and he put the stone that he had put his head on, and he set it as a pillar, and he poured oil on it, and he called the name of that place Bethel. But the name of that city had been Luz previously. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, "If God will be with me and keep me in the way that I'm going and give me bread to eat, clothing to put on, so that I come back to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God. And this stone, which I have set as a pillar, shall be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will surely give a tenth to you." Lord, you help me tonight, these next few minutes, to just be very succinct, to say what you want said and nothing else. And then, Holy Spirit, will you meet with us? I mean, just meet with us here in this place. Individually, right where we are, let us have that Bethel experience with you tonight that marks us and prepares us for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You know, Jacob was a con man. He really was. He was the ultimate con man. He was slick. He was very aggressive in greed, and he was hooked on taking the shortcut. You ever met one of those guys that will lie when the truth would fit better? Jacob's that guy. I mean, he's always looking for the easy route, the slick way. And being a family member didn't mean much. I mean, he lied to his aging father. He took advantage of his older brother and deceived him and stole his rights. And his lifelong pursuit of deceit and always going for the easy way and always trying to manipulate things had caught up with him. And his brother, Esau, was going to kill him. He really was. This is not a play on words. This is not a, "I'll kill you." Esau was literally going to murder his brother. And so now, after years of running in one direction, after years of being deceitful, years of investing himself in trying to work his own way, his life has come crashing in on him. And he has to run for his life. He has to leave behind everything he thought he had manipulated, and he wound up being blessed beyond his wildest dreams. He literally turned his life around. He literally changed from being the man his name means liar or supplanter or cheat or thief, you know, and he literally becomes the prince of God. He goes with nothing and he comes out with blessings beyond his wildest dreams. And he is the epitome of what God can do with you and me. He is the poster boy of what the Lord is able to do with us when we take some steps toward him. And I've come to tell you tonight, and I don't know most of you, I don't know your story, I don't know what's going on in your life, but Jacob is a prime example of going headlong toward destruction and suddenly finding himself completely turned around and blessed of the Lord and anointed of God and used mightily of the Lord. And so, guys, I've come to tell you tonight, God can work mightily in you regardless of where you are right now. Amen. And if you've come and you're struggling and you've come and you want more of the Lord, you've come and you're trying to just change things in your life, I've just come to remind you that the arms of the Lord are not shortened so that he cannot reach us in the depths of our despair. And his ears have not grown so heavy that he can't hear you in your agony when you call out to him. And his power has not failed so that he cannot lift you and rescue you from your self-inflicted pains. And his love has not grown
grown so cold that he can't come to us when we call out on him. He's just waiting on somebody in the room tonight to realize that you've reached the end of your way, that as we sang a while ago, you just kind of quit and said, okay, God, here it is. This is all I got. I'm giving you what I am. God is waiting on you to give up and say to the Lord, Lord, here I am, do in me what you want done. Amen. Just make me what you want me to be and take me where you want me to go, Lord. Amen. Here's the beautiful thing Paul said about this. Paul expressed it like this in Ephesians 1 and verse 19. He said that the exceeding greatness of God's power is working toward us who believe according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places. I mean, guys, that ought to get us going tonight, because God, Paul said that the mighty, incomparable power of God is working toward you when you believe in him. Amen. I mean, it's more power than you can imagine. You do know tonight the power of God is literally incomparable. I can't give you anything to compare to the power of God. It's beyond magnitude. It's immeasurable. It is off the scale. You got to create an entirely new measuring stick to begin to grasp what the power of God is all about. April the 3rd, 1974, I was a kid. I was a 15-year-old kid. Actually, I preached my very first sermon as a high school boy. April the 3rd, 1974, on a Wednesday night. That same night, at that time, the largest outbreak of tornadoes in America took place. And they came all through Alabama. And a little town called Gwin, Alabama, not very far from where I live, was literally wiped off the map by this massive tornado. Now, this is many years ago. 43 years ago, they didn't have the science and everything they have now. But I read an article about that tornado the other day. You know, we have the F1, F2, all the way up to F5. And I like the movie Twister. And then they say, what's an F5? This is, it's a finger of God, man. You know, it's this big F5. I was reading the other day that if they could have scaled that, looking back on it, they say that that probably was an F6, maybe even an F7 tornado. But the scale doesn't exist. It was so powerful and so devastating and so literally so awesome that they don't have the measurement to contain and to describe the power that was contained in that storm that night in Gwin, Alabama. That's how massive the power of God is tonight. There is nothing I can tell you that will really convey to you the immensity and the awesomeness of the power of God. There literally is nothing that God cannot do tonight. Do you get that? There's literally nothing that the Lord can't work out. There is no son represented here that God can't save. There's no daughter represented here that God can't go and rescue. There's no habit bagging you down that the Lord cannot break. There's nothing going on in your life that the Lord cannot contain and cannot control. I promise you, the power that invaded that rock tomb in a garden in Jerusalem and resurrected the emaciated and shredded body of Jesus Christ, that raised him to a seat on high, that today keeps him interceding for us 24/7. That power is flowing toward you who dare to believe tonight. God can turn your life around. God can do anything in your life. Amen. Hallelujah. If you'll stand strong, if you'll refuse to give up in the face of loss, if you'll get up when you've been knocked down, if you'll get up when you've fallen in the mud yourself, if you'll keep going when everybody else tells you it's time to quit simply because you know God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all you ask or think according to the power that works in you, God is drawn to that and God will come rushing to your side. Amen. Amen. Ah, yeah. But here's the catch. Yeah, there's the catch. You see, we all want the get-rich-quick story, don't we? It's the reason lottery tickets sell like they do, right? Even though they tell you, I looked at it the other day, the Powerball. To win the Powerball lottery is 1 in 292 million chances. You got a better chance of getting hit by lightning tonight. I mean, really, you know, just be honest, it's not there. But man, better chance to get hit with lightning, not nearly as much fun as winning the lottery, but still, you know, it's a better chance. We look at successful people and we think, man, if I could have what they have, if I could do what they did, if I had that. Most people get success by three things, a combination of hard work, right timing, and the favor of God. All right? Now, here's the hard truth. Here's the aha, the other side. Jacob had, I read to you, a supernatural encounter. Heard awesome things from the very heart of God about being blessed. I mean, he had this dynamic gotcha moment with God. And he wound up spending 21 years working out the blessing of God in his life. And it's true that with God all things are possible, but not many things worth having are easy. It's true that all the promises of God in Jesus Christ are yes and amen. But it's also true that those about rising up early and taking possession and being patient and enduring, those are promises too. Most of the good stuff God will ever give you is going to come from over there. I'm going to meddle a little bit here. Moses is out tending his father-in-law's flocks, and he's watching and he's running. You know his story. He's been and run. He's killed people. He's man, you talk about messing up. He's messed up. And he's over here and he's watching his father-in-law's flock in the desert in Sinai and all this stuff. And there's this bush that burns over here. And you ever notice that the bush was over there? And Moses said, I'm going to turn aside and see this thing. And when he turned aside, when he left his way, and this is the way God wants us to be, when he turned aside, God began to speak to him. Most of the times God talks to you, it's not going to be right here. It's going to come to you from over here. He's going to make you stop and just kind of go this way a little bit. You want to go here, but the Lord's going to say, no, I'm calling to you over here. You ever thought about John, the Revelator? John's on Patmos, and John's out there in the Spirit. He is in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and he's out there just hearing these wonderful things of God. Go read it for yourself. In the first chapter of Revelation, John says, and I heard this voice, and what he said, I then turned to see the voice that was speaking to me. Jesus is omnipotent and omniscient, and he could have appeared right in John's face, but he made the apostle John, who was in the Spirit, he made John turn to see the one who's speaking to him. I've come to tell you tonight that God can do something absolutely astounding to you in this altar. God can absolutely revolutionize your life right here and zap you with the glory of Almighty God in this room right here tonight. But most likely, it's going to take you living it out and walking it out. Zap, yeah, that's wonderful, but God's going to process you, and he's going to absolutely work you over, and it's going to be a lot harder to get out of you what God puts into you than you ever thought it was going to be. The vast majority of the time throughout the Bible, God touches a man, and then a lifetime is spent digging out the glory of the Lord that God put in him. Boy, I wanted to be a lot more than I am right now. But I'm finding out that there's so much sometimes between me getting out what God put in, you know, it takes a long time. See, Jacob had an experience unlike anything I've ever had. Jacob had a Jesus encounter in the wilderness unlike anything probably most of you have ever had. See, he's out there running, and he's fleeing, and he's in the middle of nowhere, and he meets this pre-incarnate Jesus out there in the desert. Verse 12 of Genesis 28 says, he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set on the earth. I like the ladders here, guys. It looks like somebody built. I don't know where that's going, but yeah, that's cool, you know. He dreamed, and this ladder set up, and it goes from the earth to the heaven. And he said, and remember, the angels are going up and down the ladder. Remember that he said, I saw it. The angels are going. And he woke up. He said, man, this is where God is. Now you fast forward in the Bible a few pages. Get over there to the Gospel of John. And you got a guy named Nathaniel who's out under a fig tree kind of minding his own business in the heat of the day. And Jesus calls him to be a disciple. And Nathaniel comes up and they engage in John 1 in this conversation. And the whole story is Jesus said, hey, Nathaniel, I saw you when you were under the fig tree out there. And Nathaniel was amazed. amazed because Jesus had this prescience, this ability to see beyond, and he knew what he was doing even when he couldn't see him in the physical. And he said, man, that's amazing. And Jesus looked at him and said, hey, dude, that's nothing. He said, let me tell you what's going to happen. The day's going to come when you're going to see the heavens open, and you're going to see the angels ascending and descending on the Son of Man, going to and bringing back from heaven. You go back, that's what Jacob saw. Jacob saw the angels going up the ladder and coming down the ladder. Jesus said, I am the ladder that Jacob saw. I'm the one that it goes up and it comes down on. Amen. I am he. I'm the one that takes it up and brings it down. That's a whole different story, but I've come to tell you, he encountered Jesus out there in the desert in a way that I've never encountered Jesus. He saw the pre-incarnate glory in a way I've never seen the pre-incarnate glory. He heard the voice of God, and he got the promise of God in a way I've never done it, and it still took 21 years. I've come to tell somebody tonight, don't give up just because you're not everything you thought you'd be 3 years in. Don't give up because you're still struggling 9 years in. Don't throw in the towel just because you're not everything you thought you'd be 12 years in. Don't give up serving the Lord just because you're still struggling 18 years in. Jacob met God out there in the desert, and 21 years later, he makes his way back to that same place, blessed of the Lord like never before. God has something for you if you'll just hold on to the cross of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. But how do we get beyond the catharsis moment? You know, I love emotional. I like emotional church, man. I'm wired that way. I'm hooked on it, you know. Some guys are hooked on crack. I'm hooked on the Holy Ghost junk. I love it, man. I love it. I love it. It's cool. When you do your thing, I'll do mine. I love it. You know, it's all right. But how do you get beyond that? How do we go from getting around and having that emotional moment, that catharsis moment in the altar where we weep and we pray and we hold on to each other? And as Pastor said, how do we get beyond being greatly touched to the Lord on Sunday to where we're not down in the gutter on Tuesday? You know, how do we do that? How in the world did Jacob go from hearing God to spending 21 years getting kicked around and then coming back being blessed? Okay? What did he do? Well, let me give you three things he did real quick. Number one, he like him, you're going to have to learn how to speak your worship to God. If you're going to make it, you're going to have to learn to be a worshiper. I'm sorry, you just got to do it. You got to learn how to just be vocal and open and speak your praise to the Lord. In verse 17, he got up and he said, oh, how awesome is this place. The word awesome is an Old Testament word. It's a phrase, really, in the Hebrew. It talks about how great God is. It means how fearful, how honorable, how wonderful, how miraculous is the God of this place. In Exodus 15:11, it goes like this. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? In Psalm 96:4, the psalmist said, the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. I mean, Jacob stood up and started spouting off at the mouth about how awesome God was, about how fearful the Lord was, about how tremendous God was. I mean, he just got up from his emotional experience and flat out started saying, God, there is none like you. There is no other God like you. You scare me to death. You're so awesome. You amaze me. You're so miraculous. You stun me. You're so holy. Lord, you just absolutely reverberate everything in my life. And I'm going to tell you guys, till you get to that place, you're going to get kicked around and you're always going to be down and you're going to lose the emotional high. But when you learn to get up in the middle of nowhere and say, I will bless the Lord at all times, his praise will be in my mouth, you're going to learn the secret of victory. Amen. It's kind of like this. I've led this song. We did it in Pathway. I've done it a million times since then. How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? Oh, we'll see. How great is our God? I've led that, and I've watched people worship. Yes. Weep, shout, and I watch people mouth the words, "How great is our God." Same place, same thing, you know. I've watched people standing there like this.
I got it.
I've watched people while we're doing that. I left my phone down there. I've watched people while we're doing that sitting there going. Somebody's talking about how great God is. Somebody's talking on Facebook. You know, in the same crowd, you know, we've seen that. Now, if you want God to move in your life, if you want to turn around, if you want to go in broken and come out blessed, you got to learn how to worship. You got to do it for yourself, guys. You can't count on your wife or your kids or the pastor or the worship leader. You got to learn how to break through, and you got to learn how to worship. Just a little personal aside. I knew when I went to Pathway, I followed Henry McDuffie. Henry had been there 378 years. I mean, Henry was pastoring at Pathway when the Magna Carta was signed, okay? And I love Henry. Don't get me wrong. He was there. He was Papa of that place. I love him and respect him to this day. So I knew I was going to have a hard time, J.D., getting that church to be my church. I came there telling Diane it'll take me 3 years to make this church ours. It's going to be a long time. About a year and a half into it, one Sunday morning, I looked out there. We were singing this hill song, worship song. I lift my hands, I lift my heart, I lift my voice toward the heavens. And we sang, when we got on that part and said, I lift my hands, I watched a bunch of men in that church that had known Henry and followed him all of their lives. Suddenly they started lifting their hands to heaven. I could call the name, but I won't, of one or two of them, because some of you guys know them. But I saw one man lift his hands up, and I said, that's it. It's come. It's here. He had learned to voice his praise, and it made the difference in the church, made a difference in his life. And men, I've come to tell you tonight, we got to get over our timidity and our backwardness and our inabilities, and we've got to learn to be vocal and worship and speak our praises unto the Lord. Amen. I know people talk about, well, I worship in silence. Isaiah 53:7, he was silent like a lamb before the shearers. Yeah. Now, you don't really believe that, though. People tell me all the time, I'm like Jesus, I'm silent like the lamb before the shearers. You liar. Because you complain about it being too hot. You complain about it being too cold. You complain about it preaching too long. You complain about it preaching it too loud. I mean, you know, so that kind of sets that one aside. Jeremiah 8:14, be silent before God. We messed up. Yeah. We move to Jeremiah 17:26, where we're said, bring sacrifices of praise to the house of the Lord. Yes. Amos 5:13 says, it's prudent to keep silent because of the sin in the presence of God. And but the same guy, Amos 9:11, says, where God is, he's going to rebuild the tabernacle of David, where the people worship, where the crazy sinner went in and worshiped. Now, guys, you do what you want to do, but praise is expressive in the Bible. Over and over, we're told to sing, to shout, to speak, to make a joyful noise. And if you want God to turn your life around, you're going to have to learn how to get over your timidity and praise the name of the Lord and bless the name of the Lord. If you shout when Alabama scores, you ought to be able to worship the Lord. If you shout when Auburn scores, you ought to be able to worship the Lord. If you get giddy and excited when you pull a 12-pound lunker out of the lake, you ought to be able to get giddy and excited in the presence of the Lord. And if you'd get excited if I came up and gave you $100,000 and not a soul in this building wouldn't get excited if I came up and gave you $100,000, you ought to get excited when you realize the Lord has been good to me. I will be glad and I will rejoice. So learn to praise him. Learn to bless him. Learn to worship him. Amen. Now, there's some people that are just stiff, you know. I don't believe in that worship stuff. You know, the Bible's pretty clear about this one. You are not going to stand around like a statue and praise the Lord. Worship calls on you to move. Lift up holy hands. Wave your hands, dance before the Lord, you know, leap in the presence of God. Now, I'm older than I used to be. I never could dance. I don't leap much anymore because stuff falls and it gets hurt and all that. But you younger guys, leap before the Lord, you know, whatever. And you know, sometimes we have to deal with this idea of being stuck. Because, you know, the reason a lot of you won't worship is you're really stuck. You're hung up on what somebody might say or think. You're worried about, man, what are they going to say? If I, you know, some of us are clandestine worshipers. We're going to lift our hands. We're going to go, you know. That's why you wear jackets in church on Sunday morning so you can praise the Lord. Glory. You know, we're stuck. We're worried about what people are going to say about us. But guys, your worship's not about them. Who cares what they think? They can't help you. They can't really hurt you. So just bless the Lord. Oh, Jacob's out there, you know, and man, and here's the cool thing. There's nobody out. He's not doing it to get anybody's accolades. He's not doing it so we can see how holy he is, you know. He's not praising the Lord so he can get a new music contract. It's just him and his God, and he's out there. And you know, we just got to reach a place where we're just, it's just us and our God, and that's all that really matters. And we don't care who sees us or doesn't see us. Or we've got to come to the place where his blessing means more to us than their opinion. And we just got to learn to worship the Lord and bless the name of the Lord and speak our praise to God and let the glory of the Lord come. Amen. Guys, this is why it's so important that you learn to worship. If you go forward in Jacob's life when he's an old man and he's really dying and he calls his boys in around him, he starts speaking prophetically to them. And one by one, he calls her name. And he through the voice of the Spirit, he begins to speak. He says, Reuben, you're a good son, but you're not going to conquer. Simeon and Levi, you guys are wicked. As a matter of fact, you go study, he says, I don't want anything to do with you. I'm afraid of you. You've been horrible. You've been terrible. You'll be scattered in Israel. Incidentally, Levi, you know what they did? They're the Levites come from them. They were blessed. You wonder why they got blessed? Because they were quick to repent. The Levites were the first ones to rally to Moses at the golden calf episode. They were quick to repent, kind of like David, quick to repent. And so they got there. But the tribe of Simeon was absorbed. They literally disappeared, scattered. He says, Zebulun, man, you're going to be a great man. You're going to be a shipping magnate on the ocean. You're going to have a seagoing business. Issachar, you got a strong back, a weak mind. You're going to wind up being a slave to others. You're going to be like a donkey that bears the burdens. Dan, you're going to be a judge. You're going to be wily like a serpent, which startles the horse and makes it throw the rider off. Gad, you're going to have an army. You're going to get beat up really bad, but you'll come out okay in the end. Asher, you're going to become a baker. You're going to make nice cakes. You know, going to really be good at weddings and those things. Naphtali, you're going to be a poet. You're going to be able to move men with words. You're going to be a great wordsmith. Joseph, you're going to be blessed. You're going to do great things. Benjamin, you're like a wolf. You're a killer. There's something in you lurking there that's a killer that's going to get to you. But you go back to the name of Judah, and it occurred earlier. I gave the others. And Judah, in Genesis 42:8, and Judah means worship. Judah means praise. Judah is the one that blesses the Lord. You would think Joseph would be the one that he would say, man, the Savior's coming out of you. The Messiah's coming out of you. The King's coming out of you. But he looked at the praiser. He looked at the worshiper, and he said, you're the one whose hand will be on the neck of your enemy. You're the one who's going to reign till Shiloh comes. You're the one who's going to bring forth the enemy and bring him down. Victory is not won by the deceitful, but by the praiser. Eternity is not influenced by the poet, but by the praiser. Glory is not won by the wolf, but by the worshiper. Influence with God is not obtained by the merchant, but by the praiser. If you will learn to worship, if you will oh, help me, Lord. If you'll learn to speak your praise, if you'll learn to look your adversary in the face and say, blessed be the name of the Lord, God will raise you up, and God will put your enemy under your feet, and God will assure you of victory, and your hand will be on the neck of your enemy, and God will see to it that your glory lasts and your eternity is filled with the blessings of God. Somebody ought to praise him right now. Let's just stop a minute and bless the name of the Lord. Lord, you're worthy tonight. God, you're worthy. You are worthy in this house, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Speak your praise. But it gets harder. That's the easy part. You think that's hard. Now, here's the hard part. Secondly, you've got to surrender everything in your life to God. One of you guys got up early and said, maybe instead of being a Jesus follower, we're asking Jesus to follow us. That's gone. That's gone. Jacob didn't stop with a spasm of worship, but he took this large stone on which he'd laid his head. I'd love to have been his chiropractor. How about you? You know. And he laid that big thing out on the ground, and he took oil, and the text says he poured it on the stone. When you dig deeper, he literally stood on the stone and poured the oil on himself, until it saturated everything and covered the stone. Theologians, Bible scholars, will tell us that he built what they call a cultic pillar. Down in Alabama, he made an altar and had an altar service. That's what he did. He got on an altar and he made an offering of himself to God. Now, here's what's important. You got to remember. He was where he was because he had spent his entire life running from what he just did. You got to remember, Daddy and Granddaddy were master altar builders. Everywhere Granddaddy went, Abraham, he left a well and an altar. All through that region of the Sinai, all through those arid regions, you could tell where he had gone because there was an altar and a well. But Jacob had spent his entire life rejecting what had worked for Dad and Granddad. He had spent his entire adulthood saying, I don't want anything to do with that church business. I'm sick of that stuff. I've watched you guys burn animals, and I watched you bow down and pray, and I've watched all that bloody mess, and I'm telling you, I am sick of that stuff. I'm going to do this thing my way. Alter, forget that stuff. But now, somewhere along the way, it's gotten through to him. It worked for them. Maybe it'll work for me. Oh, Holy Ghost. He took that big old flat stone, And he climbed up and he stood on it, and he said, you know what, I've been shifty and shaky all my life, but I'm standing on something now that's a lot more serious in foundation than am I. I they call me supplanter. They call me liar. They call me deceiver. But this thing right here, it's not going to move. It's going to stand strong. It will stand the test of time. It's no longer me, but it's that I'm standing on that really matters. It's no longer what I've been. It's what I'm standing on that matters. It's no longer what I've done. It's what I'm standing on that matters. Hey, guys, I promise you, I don't care what you've done, where you've been, how bad you messed up. If you'll stand on Jesus, if you'll just plant yourself on him, it'll be okay, because he's not going anywhere. He's not moving. He's not shaking. He's not going to disappear. He's not going to be moved. He's forever settled. Hallelujah. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Today, I am standing on him. Ooh, help me, Lord. And then he took the oil. Lord, please help me. And he poured that stuff on him and all that place. And that oil is symbolic of that working of the Holy Ghost. Now, I don't know if you're Pentecostal or not tonight, but even if you're not a tongues talker or whatever like that, you understand that we have nothing apart from the working of the Holy Spirit. You do know that, don't you? You do know that. You do know that right now, Jesus, the man Jesus, this amazes me still, that the man Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father in heaven praying for us, right? Yeah, he's praying. He's ever interceding to the Father for his children. When you mess up and the enemy says, look at what that idiot did, Jesus just holds out a palm with a big old nail print in it and says, I've already paid for it. He's already interceding for us. Hallelujah. He's seated at the right hand of majesty on high. The work done here is done through the Holy Spirit. Every bit of it. And he said, I give up here, seal me, cover me, fill me, flow. The Apostle Paul said something to the Ephesian believers that keeps coming up, and the older I get, the more important it is to me. In Ephesians 5, he said, hey guys, don't be drunk with wine, because that'll get you into trouble. You get a DUI. They'll put you in jail. You'll kill yourself. You'll kill some kids. Don't do that. But instead, keep on being filled with the Holy Ghost. I studied that, dug down deep in that, Pastor, a couple of years ago. And that's really sailor talk. Paul was, you know, he made tents, we're told, but most likely it was canvas. And what Paul made a lot of times was canvas for sails on those sailing vessels. And what Paul was really saying there is, guys, keep on lifting your sails, catching the wind of the Spirit, and let him drive you where you need to go. And it's dawned on me. Guys, it dawned on me after I left Pathway. It's a whole lot easier to sail than it is to row. And I pastored 25 years, and I've done a lot of other stuff in ministry. Most of my pastorate, I spent trying to row. I'm trying to row and make people like me, and I'm trying to row and, you know, get along, and I'm trying to row and raise the money, and I'm trying to row and build a church, and I'm rowing. But finally one day I realized, man, I can get a lot more done I want to tell somebody tonight, quit fighting so much and quit struggling in yourself and just learn how to lift your sails and let the Holy Spirit blow you. Be like old Jacob and say, you know what? I'm just gonna let the wind of the Lord blow me. It may blow me in a place. I may spend 21 years down here trying to get the blessing, but if the wind blows me in, it'll blow me back. And I'm just gonna let the wind of the Lord blow me. See, Jacob understood and learned something I want you to catch on to. Those old paths still work. I've written a book. I wish I had some. Those old wells still have water. That stuff that worked for grandma and grandpa, it'll work for you. And a lot, some of you younger guys in here have no idea what I'm talking about when I say this. I really feel sorry for you. I really do. But a lot of you guys know nothing about going to church and being there with people pray through. You've never even heard of the term. Some of you guys don't even know what I could be speaking Farsi. You don't know what I'm talking about. Because you've never been around where people get in an altar and they stay there till people pray through. Those old timers knew how to pray you through. Some of you know nothing of the deep, crushing, broken experience where words fail you, but the Holy Spirit through utterances you don't even understand just kind of comes out, you know. You ever been in a service where conviction was so thick that people ran to the altars? I mean, they just did it. You didn't beg them. They came. I've been a few times where I just had to quit and let them come because they're coming. You know, I got nothing to do with it. It's the Spirit of the Lord. The church I grew up in as a boy, every Sunday night, before church, this was back before we got choir practices and stuff going on a lot of times. Every Sunday night before church, the women, before service, came and they prayed on this side of the church. And the men prayed on this side of the church. If you were in here, we didn't know. And I always wonder, yeah, today we'd understand, but I always wondered, why did we do that? And I finally figured it out. These women got tired of us men praying 2 minutes and getting them stepping on them. They wanted to pray through. And we'd pray about a minute and go sit down, wait on, watch them. They'd pray through and then the glory would fall. You say, man, that sounds so simple and all. But here's the amazing thing though. This bunch of women over here could get you in an altar and they could pray you through, friend. They knew how to get young people down there and get them prayed through and off alcohol and drugs and filled with the Holy Ghost in about 15 minutes. They did more in 15 minutes than a lot of us have done in 15 years. Somehow they knew how to pray. It worked. Those old preachers back then, they didn't have degrees in education, but they could preach hell hot and heaven wonderful and they could get people saved. I'm just trying to tell you that old stuff worked and that old stuff will still work for us today. You package it any way you want to. You say what you want to say, but we've got to have a place where the Spirit of the Lord moves, where we surrender everything to God and we say, Lord, it's not about me and it's not about what I want. I'm here on this altar. You just cover me with the oil of your anointing and do with me whatever you need to do, Lord, because here I am. I am not going anywhere. Lord, I am completely surrendered up to you. Is there anybody in this place who just wants to be so sold out to God? I'll tell you what kind of guy I want to be. I don't know that I am, but I want to be. I did some study recently about the Council of Nicaea, when and all that stuff's not important. It's when the bishop's first real meeting of the church, Constantine was emperor of Rome, and he had made Christianity illegal, and they were trying to settle some issues about who Jesus was and like, when do we have Easter and those kind of things. And he sent a thing through the whole Roman Empire about all the bishops to meet. And only 318 of them could make it. That's how many showed up. It took them weeks to get there. Some were so old and frail they couldn't make it. They literally were a gathering of the martyrs. One particular guy named Paul, he was the bishop of Neo Caesarea. He came in, and Paul had to have somebody do everything for him because he had no use of either hand. His hands were withered and shriveled. He wasn't born that way. He lost the use of his hands because the Romans, in order to get him to denounce Christ, would take red hot shackles and clasp on his wrists. And they burned his wrists so much that the nerves that went to his hands were literally fried. But rather than denounce Christ, he gave up his hands. Pamphletus, the bishop of Egypt, and several others came, and they had massive scars on their right side, right here. Because rather than deny Jesus, They withstood it when the Romans literally reached in with hot tongs and ripped their right eye out of the socket and left a gaping hole and scar. And rather than announce Christ, they said, "I'll give up my eye." Numerous bunches of them came in, and the right sleeve of their robe was empty because the Romans had said, "Denounce Christ, or we'll either cut off or literally rip out your right arm." And rather than give up Christ, they endured. That's how sold out I want to be. I don't know that I am because I've not had to face it yet, but that's how sold out I want to be. That's how much of me I want to get up on that rock and how much of the Spirit I want to come on me. And I'm telling you guys, we got to have the moving of the Spirit in our lives. We got to hoist our sails and catch the wind of the Spirit. You want God to touch you? You want to do something? Yeah. Speak your praises. Speak your praises. Surrender your all. But then, this is where it really gets tough. You got to set God first in your life. Jacob did more than had, "Oh, we had a good time at meeting, ate a barbecue later." What he started at the altar, he enacted for the rest of his life. And he left there a changed man. How do I know that? Well, I know it because of what he called the place. He got up and said, "This is Bethel. This is the house of God. This isn't Luz. This is the house. This is the place where God lives. I'm coming back here. I'm going to be back here. What I have right now, I'm getting again. I'm coming back to this place. I won't chase a rabbit long, but I sure do get tired of trying to convince new converts to come to church. I'm of the old opinion that if you really get the goods, you're going to be back." The confession he made, he said, "Lord, everything I have, I'm going to give you a tithe." Now, stop thinking about that a minute. Here's a guy whose whole life's been about greed. He's there because he's greedy. He's deceived everybody. He's a huckster. He's slick. He's a snake oil salesman. He does anything for a buck. And he says, "But Lord, here, this has changed me so much. And one tenth of everything I get, I'm going to give back to you." And his consistent dedication to God is where it really gets real. Because the Lord said to him, "Son, what I promised you, granddaddy, I promised to you. Everything I promised him, I'm going to give to you. I'm going to make you great. I'm going to bring you back. You're going to have kids like the dust of the earth. The land is going to be yours. It's awesome. It's like the Lord coming to you tonight and promising you your wildest dreams. I'm going to give you. Whatever you can conceive, it's going to be given to you. Ah, son, it's going to be wonderful." And yet it took 21 years before he came back that way. I wish I could tell you we're going to pray for you in a minute, and by sundown Tuesday afternoon, wham, everything's going to happen. Maybe it will, but it probably won't. Most of us in this room are going to have to take the Jacob route. And here's the thing, you got to say, well, is it worth it? I mean, it's a real question. Is it worth it? Because while Jacob's out there, you read his story, he's out there in the cold, he's out there in the dangerous times, and every time he turns around, his uncle is ripping him off and deceiving him, and he's catching, I mean, he's just reaping what he's sown over and over and over again, and he's just reaping it, and most of us would have said, "Forget this junk, I'm going somewhere else." But he stayed there, and he hung in there, and he kept going. And you're going to have to decide, is not doing all the same junk everybody else doing, is it worth it? Is going to church on Sunday when I could be out partying late on Saturday night and late over Sunday, is it really worth getting up and going? You know, while everybody else is out at the movies having a great time and I'm home studying the Word, is it really worth it? I mean, come on, is it going to really pay off at some point in my life? You know, I guess it all depends on who you ask. You know, the Brownsville revival happened years ago. If you talk to some of the people that were part of the Brownsville Assembly of God, they wince when you bring it up. Because they'll tell you, we lost our church, as if it was their church. You know? But if you ask some kid who was selling his body for drugs, was it worth it? And God delivered him and today he's free, I guarantee you, he'll say, yeah. I want to visit Jacob one more time, and I'm going to close here. It's decades later. He had run into a dark place, afraid of his brother catching him. But he came out with such anointing on his life, Genesis 35:5 tells us everybody was terrified of him. He went in alone. He came out with a huge family. He went in broke. He came out rich. He went in being named cheater. He finally comes out, has an encounter, and is named prince. He went in with nothing but the promise of a blessing. He came out with God giving him everything God had promised his granddaddy. He went in running from everyone. But by the time he's out, he's limping before God. Was it worth it, Jacob? Oh, I'd say he'd say 1,000 times over. You see, God will mark you and God will scar you. And that time of surrender and that steadfast following God, it'll leave you marked. But listen to one last statement from the old man as he's dying. He's talking to Joseph and he's giving his will. Genesis 48:22. Moreover, Joseph, I've given to you one portion above your brothers, which I took from the hand of the Amorites with my sword and with my bow. The lame man conquered. The cripple won. The broken man got victory. The surrendered man succeeded. I know you've come here with scars tonight, my Lord. I know you've come here with wounds, and I know you come in here with your own private things that nobody else knows about that wound you and drag you down, and the enemy says you'll never be able to do anything. You'll never amount to anything. You're worthless and hopeless and crushed and crippled, and he's cruel, but he's a liar, because I'm telling you, the crippled man conquered and won. Lord, would you move on us tonight? Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place, fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place, fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome.
you is do not give up and do not allow yourself to be deceived, but press forward knowing that I am with you. Press forward knowing I sustain you. Press forward knowing that I hear you. Press forward knowing that I, the Lord your God, love you and I withhold nothing from you. Press forward, my son.
I'm struggling with exactly what I want to do. Stand with me. Let's just worship the Lord a minute. Will you do that with me? Come on, let's just spend a minute in worship. Let's just speak your praise to the Lord. Why don't you do that? Just speak your praise to the Lord. I believe God wants to meet somebody here tonight. I believe there's a man in the room God wants to meet in this room. God wants to meet. Come on. Just worship Him for a moment. Worship Him for a moment. Worship Him for a moment. Lord, help me to sort through what you want to do here. Come, Holy Spirit, and crush us in your presence. Come, Holy Ghost, and work on us. Come, Holy Ghost, and work on us. So you need to speak your praises. Come on, just learn right now. Start speaking it. This is an okay atmosphere. Just speak your praise. If you've never worshiped out loud, just tell Him, Lord, I love you. Lord, I worship you. I may be brand new at this, and I don't know everything to do, but Lord, I praise you. I don't know the jargon, but Lord, I just worship you. You're a good God. Just tell Him you're a good God. Just worship Him. Tell Him, Lord, right there, your own mouth, tell Him, Lord, I praise you tonight. I've never lifted my hands, but I'm lifting them up tonight. Lord, I don't understand all this, but I'm just doing it because He tells me to. It's in the Bible. So Lord, I just worship you tonight. Just praise Him a minute. Worship Him right there where you are. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty. I praise you, Lord. I worship you tonight. I worship you tonight. Lord, I worship you tonight. Lord, I worship you tonight. Come, Holy Ghost, and move in this house. Come, Holy Ghost, and move in the house. Oh, come, Holy Ghost, come, Holy Ghost. Come, Holy Ghost, come, Holy Ghost, come, Holy Ghost. Now, we're going to gather here and pray in a minute. Here's, I'm trying to sort through. There's so much flooding through my mind. I want to sort through. Some of you men in this room tonight need to really make a commitment to Christ. You got to get on an altar. Okay, you got to decide. You got to get on the altar and surrender everything. You got to do that. You got to decide, I'm in or I'm out. You know, I'm going to follow the Lord. I'm in, following my whole heart. It's me. I'm going to give everything I got to the Lord tonight, okay? You need to do that. You need to come to Jesus and say, Lord, here I am. Everything, I'm a sinner. I'm a messed up man. And here I am, Lord. I am a wreck. I messed up everything I've ever touched. I messed it up, Lord. I promise you, if you'll come, He'll take you. Just get on the rock. Don't worry about what you've done. Don't worry about where you've been. You just come. Get on the rock. You get on Him. He'll take care of it. He can hold it. He can take care of it. Some of you guys need to do that tonight. Say, I don't know who's coming for what, but if you got prayer teams, you may need to come with them. Some of you need to come and hoist your sails up and get filled with the Holy Ghost tonight. You need to let the Lord get it. I mean, you need to catch the wind of the breath of God. And whatever it is in your life, you need to come. Maybe you need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Maybe you need to be refilled. Maybe you need to hoist your sails again and let the Lord take you to something new. You need to come on and you need to just worship and let God do that in your life. But whatever you need tonight, if you need to give everything to Jesus, if you need to get saved, if you're a backslider and you need to come back and get back on the rock, come on, crawl up here. It's all right. Come, let the oil, let the Holy Ghost come on you tonight. Let Him breathe through you tonight. Let Him breathe through you. There's some other things we're going to pray about in a minute, but right now there's some guys that need to do that. If you're here and you don't know Jesus, you're not serving Him, come on real quickly. Let one of these prayer warriors, prayer guys help you find the Lord. We'll pray with you. You'll come to know Him. He'll forgive you. He'll write your name in heaven. He'll do away with all the sin and all the mess and all the junk. He'll slide it aside and begin a work in you that'll last you all the way to eternity. If you'll come and get on the rock tonight, He's yours, and maybe hoist your sails. Let Him fill you. Let Him breathe on you one more time. Let the Holy Ghost come. Let him come and breathe on you. Whatever it is tonight, whatever your situation is, amen. Lord, pour out your glory on these men. Save, Lord, those that need to be saved tonight. Wash them in the blood, Lord. Cleanse them, I pray. Pray. I pray, Lord, that you'd breathe newness in their life. Lord, these men that seek you to be filled again with the Holy Ghost, let them be filled with the Holy Ghost. Lord, these guys that are crying out to you right now, breathe on them, O breath of God, and flow through them tonight, I pray. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, God, pour out your glory on us, Lord. Pour out your glory on us, Lord. Pour out your glory on us, Lord. It's time, Lord. It's time to pour out your glory on us. Holy, 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 holy. Holy God, holy God, holy God, holy God. Sanctify people. Lord, give men victory over things that are besetting sins, and give men victory over things that cripple them. Give men victory over things, Lord, that hinder their walk with you. Grant us freedom. Grant us liberty. Grant us anointing. Grant us your peace. Grant us your grace. Breathe on us, O God, and make us yours. Make us like Jacob, men who are determined, Lord. We're going to experience your glory. We're going to lift our way to victory, Lord. We're going to lift our way to victory, God. We're going to lift our way to victory. I want them to keep praying. I want to do one more thing. In the room tonight, there are men like me who have things in your life where you need the power of God to show up. It may be a lost son or daughter. It may be a situation in your marriage. It may be a job. It may be a physical thing in your body. It could be a thing where you're fighting depression. It could be anything. It doesn't matter what it is. But I want us to get in this altar together and pray that the power which raised Christ from the dead and seated him on high will flow toward us and will work miracles in our lives and in our needs. If you're here tonight, you got anything you need God to do, you need the power of God to work in your life, I want you to come get real quick. All of you guys, we're just going to come stand right here. We're going to pray a prayer together, one for another. And then I know we got food to eat in a minute, and it's hard to compete with that. But I believe God can release power in the room tonight. And somebody's son can be saved. And somebody's marriage can be healed. And somebody's sickness can be driven out. Somebody's job situation can be changed. And God's able to do all things tonight. And so I want us to pray. Come on, guys, get out here and just kind of reach over there and lay your hand on somebody by you. Just touch them on the shoulder if you're comfortable in doing that. And begin to pray. Say, Lord, I pray that the power of the Holy Ghost will be released in my brother's life. Let the power of the Holy Ghost be released, Lord. Bring his kids home. Lord, make a way for his job. Lord, make a way for him, I pray. Lord, give him strength, I pray. Lord, anoint him. Let that depression be broken, Lord, and let the financial pressure be alleviated. Lord, let him come out victorious. He's gone in running, but let him come out limping for your glory and your anointing. Lord, let your power fall. Let the glory fall. Let the anointing fall. Make a difference in us, Lord. We'll follow you, God. We'll limp if we have to, Lord, but we're going to make it through because we are committed to you, God. Now let the power, let the anointing come. Let your glory come. Let my brothers be made strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Claim your sons. Claim your daughters. Claim your marriages. Claim your home. Claim your church. Stand there, anointed of the Holy Ghost. Claim your healing and let God work in you tonight. Hallelujah. Let the glory and the anointing of the Lord flow in you tonight. Hallelujah. His passion.